Stephen, lovely to see you. Loads to talk to you about.
Wow.
Films, cartoons. First things first, your podcast that you do with Ricky and Carl is like my default thing on my iPod. Do you ever feel guilty for bullying him so relentlessly?
Well, the thing about Carl Pilkington, if you've never met him, is that the man is a moron, and a lot of morons, they don't really care what happens. Do you know what I mean? They couldn't care less. We come in, we bully him relentlessly for hours on end, and he goes home perfectly happy. I don't think he's even listened to what we were saying. He just goes about his business, he's more than happy, so no, don't feel bad for him. Continue to laugh mercilessly at him in all formats.
I do. What's his girlfriend / fiance wife, I'm not sure her their status, what's she like? Is she pretty normal?
Carl's girlfriend Suzanne is a lovely woman. She's very smart, she's very successful, very professional, she works for the BBC, and I've often wondered what their relationship is. I haven't spent enough time with them. I suspect it's very similar to a carer and like a small child. It's got that sort of dynamic, I think.
And where does he get Monkey News from? And I love that jingle, by the way.
Yeah, I fear that Monkey News is almost entirely bullshit. He seems to get a lot of it from the web. You may remember classic Monkey News includes a monkey that was a builder on a building site, a monkey fireman, a monkey who was a barber, ran a barber shop successfully,
the philanderer, of course,
the philandering monkey who stole another person's human's girlfriend. So I fear that some of it is gleaned from the web, which he believes is a repository of fact.
Now you turned that into a cartoon, haven't you?
Yes.
What's going on there?
Well, there's obviously quite a large audience that already are familiar with it, but there's obviously a vast number of people who haven't ever seen it, particularly in the States. And so our American agent was like, why don't we sort of animate it and we can maybe bring it to another audience? So, it's going to be on Channel 4 here at some point. And, it's essentially our conversations, real-life conversations, but with our animated versions of us. And actually being able to see some of Carl's ramblings brought to life, you know, visually is actually really charming.
Do you think the Americans will get his moronic ramblings?
Almost certainly not. Although actually, weirdly, we've already got quite a large sort of American following for the podcast.
So Ricky's massive over there.
Ricky's a big star over there. So I don't know. Maybe. Who knows? I don't know.
And Cemetery Junction.
Yes.
Talk to me. What's that all about?
Well, Cemetery Junction is a film. Ricky and I have made it. It's coming out in April 14th. And Empire Magazine just gave it a lovely review. That's the only reason I'm here. It's a sort of coming of age sort of feel good drama about some guys growing up in the 70s in a small town, and their dreams of sort of wanting to leave and wanting to escape, and hopefully it's quite funny and quite romantic and quite dramatic and quite, you know, quite, and there's some dancing in it, if like dancing's your thing. So
there's some dancing in it as well,
but not in a sort of high school musical way, you know.
You're mopping up the dirty dancing crowd.
Exactly. So yeah, there's something for everyone.
And it's a bit autobiographical, I believe.
A little bit autobiographical. Rick and I have drawn on our experiences of growing up, it's a slightly romanticised version of the past, because we didn't want it to be an English film that's really gritty and grimy and dark and gloomy. So we hopefully it's quite bright. It's like I remember growing up, it always seemed bright, you know, it always seemed fun and sunshine, and so that's what we sort of tried to capture in the film.
A nice optimistic. Well, last thing, Stephen, is obviously, you know, success came relatively late to you and Ricky, didn't it, really? I mean, you know, it sort of almost happened overnight, Office, and then it's just gone from strength, and now you're both absolutely huge. Would you have any sort of kind words for any late bloomers out there who perhaps, you know, late 20s, early 30s, thinking, can I make it?
I think so. I mean, you know, Ricky was, I think, 35 or something when I met him, and we did The Office. And I think he was in his late 30s by the time we did The Office. So I agree. I think there's any reason why you can't carry on doing stuff even as you get older. I mean, you say I was a late bloomer. I think you'll find I won my first BAFTA before I was 30. So I don't want to. No, I mean, if you're going to bring it up, let's get the facts right. But, as I say, I think there's, particularly with comedy, I think that, you know, I find that people get funnier as they get older. You know what I mean? You don't want a kind of sexy, cool person making you laugh when he's 21. You want someone who's kind of lived in, who feels like life's beating them down. That's what makes me laugh. So, like Eric Morecambe or someone. So that's, you know, I say go for it.
Who's your comedy hero?
I think it's Morecambe. I think it's Eric Morecambe. If I had to go on Desert Island Discs and choose a luxury item, this is an exclusive for you, I would have a picture of Eric Morecambe. Every morning I think I'd wake up and I would just go, I would be pleased. You know, he brings joy to my heart.
That's so, pretty low maintenance, Stephen.
It's pretty low maintenance, isn't it? I mean, I would starve on the island very quickly. I'm not conscious of that, but I'd die laughing.
Fantastic, Stephen. Lovely to meet you. I'll probably listen to you on the way home tonight. Have a great time in there, and look forward to the film coming out.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Cheers, mate. Cheers.